OK, let's look at so what it's all about. So first, before going to the microservice, let's look at what is the monolithic architecture, monolithic application. So monolithic application puts all the functionality into a single process. When you come to the scaling of monolithic application, it's scaled by replicating monolith on multiple servers. In the other hand, the microservice, also known as microservice architecture, puts each function into a separate service. And when you come to the scaling, scale by distributing all these services among different servers. That's the fundamental of microservice architecture. So let's look at few characteristics of microservice architecture, and we'll see what are the challenges, what are the problems, and how we can overcome all of these problems. Number one, so componentization as a service. What is a component here? Component is a software unit that you can link to your program. So there's a small mismatch or like a misunderstanding here. People are thinking libraries also as a component. So that is not correct, right? So the libraries are linked to a program and call using in-memory calls. But the service is a out-of-the-process component that you can communicate to service using well-known protocol like web service, remote procedure calls, etc. And the main reason of using service as a component is the service can independently deployable, but libraries you can't, right? Then second one is where microservice should be organized around business capabilities, like maybe user interface, maybe integration front. Depending on your business capabilities, you should create your microservices. And other thing is microservice architecture is advocating is smart endpoint and dumb pipes. Okay, if you look at this one, this is the anti-ESP pattern. Right? So when you are dealing with ESP, so all the integration is happening in the middle, the centralized integrations. But in the microservice architecture, what we advocate is if you want to do integration, you are doing microservice itself. There are some practical implications, and also there are some solutions. So we'll discuss later in my slides. OK, so other thing is microservice architects advocating is cross-functional team. For example, if your team is consist of DB experts, and maybe UI expert, UX experts, or middleware experts, so then this team should be self-sufficient to do whatever they are developing within the microservice scope. They should not depend other teams' members to do it. OK, so a few things. So microservice architecture doesn't influence any programming language. You can use whatever you like to use. It can be a Go, it can be a Python, it can be a Node, it can be a Ballerina. So depending on your experts, or depending on your use case, you can choose your programming language. Same thing as you can use any data types. If you are familiar with XML, you can use XML. If you're OK with JSON, you can use JSON. There's no influence from the architecture. It depending on your use case and the UI experts in your team. And also, if you are using a like cloud native programming language, in practice, you can get more benefits, like optimizations. So I will discuss some of the points in my later slides. OK, this is like a real problem when you are doing a microservice architecture. So this like in microservice, not mean to have a number of lines of code in your program, right? So when you are thinking, when you are scoping out the microservice, it's totally dependent on your use case, again, and your expertise in your team. this problem should be handled within the team. And team should be fit into a two pieces. What does that mean? So if your team can't serve by two pieces, that means your team is too large. Either you should have a maximum of team should be fit into a two pieces or less than that. Then you can have more innovations and controllability in the program itself. And there's no tools or there's no frameworks that help you to define this scope. So it's totally depend on your problem and the skill factors in your team. Okay, so I like to give a few advice. So basically, so if you look at the 10 years ago, we had this SOA era, right? Everyone wanted to do SOA, right? So this is a lesson we learned, right? So don't do it because everyone else is doing it. You should have a proper use case to do it, right? That need, number one, need to be identified. And you should, when you want to do this, you should use a correct strategies when you are moving monolithic to microservice. So there's a very famous quote saying that, I like that quote. So if you are moving monolithic to microservice, it's like you are creating chicken nugget while chicken in live. You can't kill the chicken because you can't stop your business, right? But you have to, if you want to move into the microservice, you have to have some kind of strategy there. One strategy is that you can use the ice cream scoop strategy. That means you can take simple problems from your monolithic application and create in the microservice and run parallel all my monolithic and microservice, and eventually you can convert all the functionality in your monolithic to the microservice. That's a very famous strategy. There's another strategy. We call it a nuclear bomb strategy. You can write your microservice as a separate effort, and when you're done with, we can just switch your traffic to the new microservice architecture while shutting down the monolith architecture. So these strategies are depend on your use case and your rolling out mechanism that you use going in microservice architecture. Another thing is, we should have a proper balance, right? So the main concept is here, microservice architecture, agility, right? So in the monolithic architecture, we had this agility problem, right? Whenever we want to do some small feature rolling out, we have to roll out the full system, right? Now with the microservice, we can roll out that is microservice itself, rather touching to the whole system, in the your application. And the key thing is, we should have a frequent checkpoints. So in my practice, you can't 100% scope out a microservice at the beginning of the project. This is not a waterfall kind of architectural design. So we should have a frequent review points. This development cycle should be at least less than 2 weeks. Then every checkpoint, you have to think about, okay, whether my scope is correct, or the way I want to put more in function into my microservice, like I have to divide this function into different microservice. So that's an evolving process. So you can't define upfront all things in the microservice architecture. Okay, so let's look at a few challenges. Since now we are doing microservice architecture, microservices, that is single, you can't run your application in single microservice. That means we need to have a bunch of microservices. So that means we are going to develop a distributed application, distributed system. So if we all know that there's a lot of problem coming with the distributed system. We have to face all these problems in the microservice architecture. You can't avoid it. So number one, since we have an increasing number of microservices, how we can identify the, how we can discover other services? Earlier case, if you have monolithic, it is an internal call, It's a memory call. Now it is a network call. First, we need to discover that service, then we need to communicate with that service. Network communication, you all know, right? There's a network latency issues, network resilience issues. Then how we can solve this problem? Next, again, now, since we have small services, and they can be scaled independently, now we should have some kind of load balancing. So that's, again, another problem. And we should have some kind of failover mechanism, right? Asynchronous, or maybe circuit breaking, right? Then, when you come to testing, if it's a single application, obvious, right? We can test, we can run a test case against a single application very easily. Now, since we have a distributed application, running a global test is very hard. Then we need to address how we can run the global testing. Then come to the monitoring, tracing, all things are not an easy. Other thing is now, so we are advocating now small teams, small microservices, they are developing service independently, but they are developing a one single application. Now when you come to the combining all these applications, how we can do the policy enforcement or the governance? So if individual applications have their own way of doing the authentication, authorization, own traffic management, then how we can have a governance model for the whole application? That's another problem. Then, now, since we have several microservices, now we need to have some kind of orchestration mechanism. We need to patch them, we need to update them, we need to have some kind of rolling update mechanism. So all these problems are coming with microservice architecture. And so while these problems are coming, in the software community or industry, try to solve this problem by different, providing different technology, different tools and frameworks. Let's look at what are the technology that help to your in your microservice application development. Number one, containers. That's the famous one is a Docker implementation. How many of you are using Docker in this room? Okay, that's good. That's very good trend. So what does Docker provide? So Docker provide an isolation, right? So I'm sure you have used the VM, right? Virtual machines, Amazon or VMware. So compared to the VMware or the virtual machines, the container, they are very lightweight because there's no OS component inside the container. So you can boot up a container within a milliseconds. In the VM case, it takes maybe a 10 seconds, right? Now, since it's lightweight and you can have a fast boot up, and Docker provides the immutability. What is immutability? So that means whenever you deploy something into the production, you are not changing that server or container. If you want to do another change, you're rolling out another container, and you can route the traffic to the new one. That's a lot of benefit. If you are off sweeper, you know how benefit we are getting out of that. So if you want to roll back, it easily roll back to the previous container. So all the other beauty thing is container is providing a universal packaging model. What is this universal packaging model? You can, when you write your application after building up, you can package your application with all the dependencies, all the configuration, and make a Docker image. That's a binary. And this Docker image can be run dev, test, stage, or production without changing anything. You can pass Swift configuration if you want, environment-specific configuration, via environment variables, but 99% you can run as an immutable container. That's a very good benefit we are getting out of this container technology. Okay, now the reality. So I talk about them running microservices in a containers. Now, if you're looking at the application, you can't run single application in single microservice. That means you can't run single application in single container. That means you need to have a bunch of containers to run your applications. Right? Then the problem is how you can manage all these containers. So for that, there's a solution come with a computer industry, that is container management system or container orchestration system. The Kubernetes is a well-famous container orchestration system. So this is open source 4 years ago. You may all know that Google running containers more than a decade. So if you are spinning up a Gmail or you are Geek Dog, so Google will spin up a container for you in their Google data center. So it has all the controllability, security within that container, right? So basically what Google is saying that they are deploying billions of containers a week. So that's a large number, right? Then how they can manage that? Without managing all these billions of containers, you can't survive. So they use a system called Borg. So they use this Borg more than a decade now. And 4 years back, they open sourced their experience with the Borg system, community project called Kubernetes. And now this is the number one community project in the software industry at the moment. Right? All the Microsoft or IBM, Red Hat, Google, even Amazon, all are contributing to this project called Kubernetes. So I just briefly explain what is Kubernetes. So Kubernetes has a control plane. So that's the Kubernetes, we call it Kubernetes master. It can come with API server, etcd, controllers, and et cetera. Now, user can interact with Kubernetes using an API calls. It can be a CLI call, it can be a UI call, it's an API call, right? So user can pass their payload as a JSON object or YAML object to this API server. Then this control plane get this payload, workload, and distribute among their worker nodes. User doesn't know where it is running, what is the kernel versions, what OS is running, doesn't need to be know, right? User want to know, just run my payload across the high availability and the occurs multiple clusters with the high availability and the scalability. So that's provided by the Kubernetes. I'm not going to detail, but I will explain two primitives, Kubernetes primitives. If you want to learn more about Kubernetes, there's a session in Sanjay called Deploying Application in Kubernetes and Docker. Participate to that. I will explain two primitives because I want to use these primitives in later slides. One is Kubernetes pod. So I explained that in practice, you can't run application in single process or single container. So that means we need to run multiple containers. Sometimes you need to run these containers in very tightly manner. Sometimes we need to have some kind of sharing within two containers. So pod is for that. Pod is the smallest scalable unit in Kubernetes. It can run multiple containers within the single pod. What the benefit? Within the pod, you can have some kind of sharing. You can have a network sharing. You can have a volume sharing. You can have a inter-process call sharing. So while providing the isolation from the container level, like controllability, like CPU controllability, memory controllability, also it has some kind of sharing. So that's give very flexible to run your application in enterprise manner. And this unit can be scaled as a scalable unit. Second one is Kubernetes service. So Kubernetes service is a virtual load balancer. So I explained that there's a problem when you're having a microservice, how you can do the load balancing and how you can do the discovery. This is one way of solving that. So when you are creating Kubernetes service, it do the load balancing and also it do the discovery. It create a virtual DNS within your cluster. You can access using your DNS name. It can discover all the running ports for that DNS name and do the load balancing within the cluster. Kubernetes service can have multiple load balancer type. It can be exposed to the external network, or it can be limited to the internal network. Depending on the Kubernetes service type, you can define it. I'm not going to detail. OK, so now let's look at few deployment strategies that help to it'll help you in a microservice architecture. So I talk about microservices all about agility. Now we can innovate fast. It is not enough. We have to deploy this innovation into production now. So how we can do that? So there's one strategy called blue-green strategy. What is the blue-green strategy? So normally, when you are running a set of application, so set of microservices, we can take as a blue deployment. Now, blue-green strategy is when you want to deploy new updates, you want to do a rollout, you can do a blue, we have a green deployment, now we can have a blue deployment. So if you're using Kubernetes, there's a rolling out command, you can do it within using Kubernetes as well. Now when you are deploying the blue one, you can do that testing and some load balancing. When you're happy with that, you can switch the traffic from green to blue. If there are some issue happening, if you find out there's some problem in your new deployment, you can switch back to the green one, right? So there's no downtime. You can do rolling update, rolling out within zero downtime, right? So second one is concept called canary updates. What's a canary update? So in canary update, you can do traffic partitioning. So we have a green deployment, you have a new blue deployment. Now you want to do some traffic partitioning and send to the new deployment. For example, maybe we can say 10% of my traffic should be go to the new system. And you can try that system maybe 1 week, depending on your use case. And this traffic partitioning can be in different forms. Say if your application is rolling out a new feature, maybe that feature is more useful for the age group 20 to 30. If you want to try out that, we can, if your load balancer can identify, or if your router can identify, if your routing engine can identify age group of your traffic, we can just route that age group to the traffic to the new deployment, having all traffic into the old deployment. That is, we call it A-B testing. There's a very famous methodology. Facebook is using this A-B testing heavily. So basically, when they are rolling out a new feature, they're rolling out that feature to a selected user group. First one is internal network, second one is selected user group. Then only they are rolling out to the entire system. OK, there's another thing. Another way of doing that, traffic shadowing. So what is traffic shadowing? Now, say if you are running a system with a set of your microservices, now you want to test the new system. What you can do is you can have a traffic shadow. While sending your traffic to the old system, you can create a same traffic to your new system. Then you can do some kind of performance testing, functional testing, and that is a real production testing. This is now getting famous, right? So if you want to do that, then you are more confident enough to roll it to the new system, right? So if you want to do all this kind of system, you can't do it manually. You have to use some kind of tooling, right? Okay, there's another interesting technology called mesh. We call it service mesh. So service mesh is trying to solve this governance and policy enforcement. So I talk about that there's a problem in microservice architecture. How you can do the policy enforcement, how you can do the governance. So service mesh want to solve that. And it want to solve that service discovery and resilience, network resiliency, version control, and deployment and update orchestration mechanism, right? So this is like, so we use our ESPs, right? Now it's a centralized ESP. Now this is like a distributed ESP, right? So mesh is kind of a distributed ESP. You can do some policy enforcement and some network layer resiliency within the mesh. How you can do that? There's a concept called sidecar proxy, sidecar. If you know this analogy, so this motorbike can attach another cart. We call it sidecar. Same analogy. If you apply to your microservice, you can attach another proxy service agent to your microservice. Now, this proxy service can control all the ingress and egress controllers. That means you can whenever traffic going out of your microservice, you can do the network resiliency. If you want to push circuit breaker parameters configuration, you can apply it within the proxy service. If you want to do traffic control, ingress one, if you want to do traffic throttling, you can do within the ingress controller, right? So the benefit is, without the average developer or the business developer asked to do that, these things in their business logic, we can do these things in another proxy layer called sidecar proxy. So this thing is now getting very famous. And there's we can do is, we have a business logic. There's a circuit breaker in the sidecar. There is service discovery in sidecar. All things happening in the proxy layer. So this is like a transparent proxy. Even the microservice developer doesn't know anything about this sidecar thing. It transparently put all the traffic going via this proxy server, right? So the well-known implementation of the service mesh is Istio. So Istio has this control plane and data plane. So they're using Envoy proxy. And within that, you can do service discovery, network resiliency, circuit breakering, all this stuff. And they have the control plane. They have a pilot, which push all the policies configured into their data plane, the proxy. And there's a mixer who collect all the telemetry and do some decisions. And Citadel is they can do the authentication authorization. It's mutual certificate distributing among all this cluster. So this is very famous and healthy project. Okay, so I explained few technologies. So this is true in software industry, right? You can't avoid this one. Every time, every week, there's a new technology. So let's look at one more thing, so serverless. So what is serverless? That means there's no servers to run our application or services. Then where is our services running? There's no servers? Okay. Actually, there is a servers. There's a containers. But thing is, these containers or services are not always running. They run on demand. Right? They appear whenever request comes and disappear after that. Can we do that? Let's look at it. And since we don't want to maintain any servers, we don't want to think about any servers, we can focus our business logic and we can get other framework or tool into do the other things. Few serverless, famous serverless vendors, Amazon Lambda, Azure Function, Google Function, right? There's a 2 weeks back, there's a project heavily in Google involvement. There's a project called Knative, did open source project, and that's now open. So all other cloud providers has different implementation, because if you want to do a Lambda function, you have to write a function for their signature, function signature. But in the Knative, what advocating is, you can run your own function, you can run your own service as a serverless. Okay, so briefly, this is a Knative architecture. It uses Kubernetes, Istio, and they have the Knative control plane to manage this serverless functionality. Let's briefly look at our demo. Hopefully it's working. In the morning, my machine was crashed and I want to... Okay, so I am running a Knative cluster in my machine. Right. So I'm not going to explain a lot of things. So basically, I deploy an application using this my application. I use a simple PHP application, print hello world, and I'm deployed using a kubectl command. Kubectl is a Kubernetes command. So if you look at kubectl, so get pods means there's no running pods now, right? So I just put the watch here. There's no running pods. Now I'm going to hit my service, and it should be trigger their interest controller and create ports on demandly, and it will. I have set up my configuration to run in 30 second. If there are no idle time, if you are 30 second is idle, then it will destroy all my cluster and rerun again when the next request. So I'm going to run using this command. So I'm going to curl. So it's first request getting up. Now you can see it captured the first request and it's spinning up all the containers. When it's ready, it's running now. And it should be get the response back. Now second request, fast, because it is running, right? So let's keep 30 seconds. Then you can see this will be shutting down my cluster. So this is like a serverless implementation. This is a Knative. So this is just a service, simple PHP service. I haven't run any functional signature for that. I just use my own function, own hello world function. So I were able to run my function without changing my code in serverless manner. So let's, okay. Now we start terminating, you can see. So it there's idle time, then it start terminating. Okay, thank you very much.